he was very modern in outlook, and he participated in converting Nadi reading through a software so that you can, just like ECG, you can figure out what are the problems associated with the reading of the Nadi. I think it was a very, very tough subject. Very patiently he has worked. I think now he has had success. I think some of this electronic gadgets have been sold, and perhaps many more will be sold in the coming, because it's very difficult, because these normally Vaidyas are very secretive. They don't easily develop successors, you know. I think that's a peculiar trait of these people, you know. They confine knowledge to themselves, but here was a Nadi Vaidya, remarkable personality, who was willing to support such a program. I now have great pleasure in talking about a highly performing person. And I think you guessed it right, is Anirudh Pandit. Well, I would go back, what, Anirudh, 35, 37 years ago. Here comes a young man, although belonging to Shivaji Park area, but coming all the way from the great place of Banaras, Sankat Mojan Hanuman Temple followers. He still loves Banaras, obviously, and for good reason. He waited till JB came back from Pittsburgh, and it has been a long drawn, very fruitful association. What Anirudh has achieved is truly remarkable. He has, I think no one, I think you have surpassed JB in terms of citations, no? That itself should make JB very proud. Yeah, you know. And that no matter whom you send to Anirudh, that fellow feels very happy. I'm saying this with some experience, whether it was a new consulting assignment or somebody upcoming who wanted to do something, they will go and get charged with Anirudh Pandit. But I also take you back soon after his PhD, when he was to go to Cambridge, and I had occasion to see him in Cambridge while he was doing postdoc work. And Cambridge people were very fond of him. John Davidson, his mentor there, had a suspicion they are trying to lure him. But we worked hard on him that you come back, you'll be better off. And he has been an extraordinary addition to the faculty. He's still not in the pay of Institute of Chemical Technology. He's paid directly from University Grants Commission. He's a UGC scientist of equivalent to professor. I don't know what. And he's one of those persons, I can talk a lot about Anirudh, and he knows I'm very fond of him. He's a very pleasant person, where always charged with positivism. That's what I like most. His outstanding work, you have heard. Again, I refer to, I cannot help referring to DNA of UDCT, ICT. That is hardcore research, as evident in the most learned public journals of the world, and deliver it to the marketplace. And Anirudh Pandit, that training he wouldn't have got in Banaras, for sure. That is a peculiar and hard-earned DNA for generations in ICT. So I present to you Anirudh. Being first PhD student, he would have many remarkable recollections that others didn't have.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, for such a generous introduction. And I'm going to add, I'm sure many will speak many things about Professor Joshi, and as was pointed out, being his first student, I was the only student at that time, and at least for a period of nearly 1 year, I was the only student which he was guiding. Obviously, you can imagine, when all of that energy is concentrated on one student, you can imagine my condition. But that is what trained me. That is what trained me. So all the attributes which Professor Sharma talked about, positivity, positive thinking, patience, which Smita talked about, is indeed the one which I have drawn from him. The ability to teach. When ICT started a Best Teacher Award in the memory of Professor, late Professor R.A. Rajadeksha, Professor Joshi was the first recipient of that particular award. And this is an interesting award, that this is an award which is chosen by the students, and it could be from any of the teachers from 4 years during their coursework. And there were four criteria which were given for that particular award. First is the clarity of thought. Second is the way these thought processes are delivered to the students. Third, promote the thinking ability, creative thinking ability. And fourth, concern for the student. And I'm sure there is no better person than Professor Joshi meeting all those four criteria wherever you take it. And you can still see based on whatever has been talked about since morning. When Smita said that I've never seen angry, Sharma sir said, no, but he does get worried. And I know he does get worried. And you can read his face. What you have to see is eyes and the forehead. A slight crease develops on the forehead, indicating a slight annoyance. As the crease broadens or deepens, you can judge the level of annoyance. But it just doesn't go beyond that. It just stays there. Second thing which Smita talked about is walking in the class with just two chalks in the hand and conduct a class of 2 hours, starting from the basics till the end. But one thing which many of the teachers don't follow, that before you leave the class, you clean up the blackboard, clean it and make it, keep it ready for the next lecturer to come. That's another thing which is noticeable. That also shows concern for the person who's going to follow. Smita talked about picnic. Now, this picnic always had a hidden agenda. It was never a picnic. And this hidden agenda was actually to understand the local issues and the local problems and try to find out what could be the engineering solutions to those particular problems. And he had that firm belief, and he's absolutely right in that, then when these students, young students, will go and experience that feeling, that surroundings, that location, they themselves will understand what solutions can come about, what sort of problems they are likely to face, so on and so forth. Which is a subtle way, rather than if you tell that you go and work on this particular problem, and I'm sure all the problems which you talked about whether it is drying of grapes or problems which Rohan has been talked about, all these problems have come out during one of the picnics. And then these problems have been now consolidated and people have started working on it. I've had an opportunity to travel with Professor Joshi together many times, in train, in bus, including BST bus. We would sit together, travel, and what Professor Sharma talked about, what Mashelkar also talked about, that he would go and sit in front of or outside the office of DTE, waiting to be called, even when he was a director. And we would sit together. If we had a proper subject where we felt that someone had to contribute or any one of us contribute, we would talk And we would talk very, very passionately. If we didn't have anything to talk about, both of us would just keep quiet for an hours together, lost in their own thoughts, in each other's thoughts. And then, if you felt that there is something interesting which has come out, we would talk about it. Meghna talked about shopping. Indeed, again, there is a hidden agenda in that shopping. I have seen him taking his granddaughters for shopping as well. And the objective there, the hidden agenda, is to have a feel for the numbers, the feel for the costs of various things. He would be curious to know how the rice price has changed, how the wheat prices have changed, how the sugar prices have changed, how the oil prices have changed. He would have those numbers, and he is extremely curious to know those numbers, the trend in those particular numbers. That is how you are able to visualize a bigger picture. Otherwise, it's just not possible for you to have a bigger picture and a vision which is universally applicable. I'm not going to hog the time, but what I have learned from Prof Joshi, I have summed it up in 5 specific points. I'll just state those particular points and then conclude. First, tremendous patience, especially dealing with students. You can get really annoyed, and sometimes students can be exasperating. But beyond that, you have to go, and you have to have tremendous patience and always a positive attitude, a positive approach. Second, do not easily form an immediate opinion when you are dealing with the system or dealing with an individual or meeting with an individual. Don't form immediate opinions. Do not offer comments, suggestions, solutions without studying the problem in depth. You always look at the two sides of the coin, or sometimes even more than two sides, look at the edges of the coins to be able to understand what is the gravity of the problem. Fourth, persist with the efforts. Never give up. First efforts may not have an optimum solution, but they will offer a solution, but at least the direction in which the solution is likely to be found. And think of a property to be measured which will give you a clue in terms of cause and effect. Think of simple solutions. Think of basic science which you have learned in school days, rather than trying to find writing complicated equations to start with. If there is a need to write a complicated equation, of course, do it. But don't start with that. Try to find out the simple solutions. These are the 5 things which I have learned, and I would like to wish Professor Joshi a long, healthy, and fruitful life, and sincerely hope that he continues to guide us for years to come. And I'm eternally grateful for my 3 gurus, as I always considered it. When I got a fellowship of Indian National Science Academy, I said, I have 3 gurus, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. I don't know which one is which, but Professor Sharma, Professor J B Joshi, and John Davidson of Cambridge. Thank you very much, sir.
I have pleasure in presenting to you Dr. Sudhir Panse. He's an active member of the Marathi Vignan Parishad, so obviously he must be in fairly regular contact with JB. I think you spend all your weekends there, apart from your mind being occupied with Marathi Vignan Parishad all the time, you know. He was director of BCUD in the University of Mumbai. This is the position of chief academic officer in the university. After his retirement in 2006, he joined UDCT, now ICT, as adjunct professor in physics, where he was actively involved in research project of harnessing solar energy. His area of research in physics, thermodynamics, and solar energy. He has authored a book titled Scientific Temper in Marathi, which is, you know, very hot topic these days. People say you must have scientific temper, and very many of these persons who say should have scientific temper themselves don't have.
Professor Joshi, Professor Sharma, Dr. Kakodkar, Yadav sir, and all the ladies and gentlemen who have gathered here. So much has been talked about Professor JBJ that it would be very difficult to speak something different, something new, a separate angle. However, fortunately, I have worked with him in a capacity and during a period where I have slightly different aspect. I know a slightly different aspect of Professor J.B. Joshi. Everybody has said, and that is true, that he is a teacher par excellence. He is a researcher who is extremely successful. He has been an industrial consultant, which is very notable. But along with all this, he has been a philanthropist. He has been a person who has worked for the society and done societal work. Along with all this, there is one more aspect. And really one wonders how many different aspects can one personality have. This another aspect is, he is a very good administrator. He worked as a director of ICT for a long period, 10 years. And not all 10 years, but there was a period later, the last phase, where after I retired from university and college, then I joined ICT, and initially I was working there as chief administrative officer. So we were working together, I was working under him. And that time I have seen him as an administrator, and I can tell you he is an excellent administrator. Various capacities, various faculties, various properties which a good administrator should have, he possessed all of those. Some of those we know, that any good administrator should be someone who doesn't lose his balance anytime, who is always calm and quiet. And we know that J.B. Joshi is a very calm and quiet person. People have said here that it is very difficult to see him angry. But as an administrator, there are times when one has to be very firm and maybe at times very strict, very angry. I have seen this happen once. When we were working together, he was the director. And one faculty member, one staff member, she came and complained. And apparently she was quite disturbed because the students had disobeyed her. And the way the students reacted to her, she felt that she was insulted. Perhaps her reaction was a little extravagant. But even then, she was complaining. And as a director, JBJ had to take a stand. So that was the time when I saw that he called all those students, all that group of students, and then he fired them like anything. Of course, his voice did not rise. He was even then speaking very softly, but the words, the expression on the face, this I have seen also sometimes later. It happens very momentarily. But in our group of research students who are doing solar research, if one finds that a student is trying to avoid the responsibility, then you can easily make out that he is annoyed, and he communicates it very effectively. That is the strength of a good administrator, that without using a single harsh word, without raising his voice, he communicates this. I have seen this, he doing this, with a faculty member that time also. He is very soft-spoken. He is very acceptable. And whatever points you put to him, he will listen to it very carefully. But I'll tell you, he is at the same time very stubborn person. If there are some things where he is not ready to accept, and if it is his responsibility as the person who is heading the administration, then he is very stubborn. And there were some occasions where senior faculty members also wanted some decisions which he said that they are not correct, they are not proper, ethical, and therefore he would not succumb to that. And that is the stand he took, even at the cost of being unpopular for some time. He had to face a little difficult period that time. There was some problem. It turned out that some of the close associates, close colleagues who were working for many years, they also did not come out in full support. But at that time, he kept his cool, and he was very firm, and he always meant to be ethical. I remember that in order to face that situation, also, it was a very, now looking back, I find it was a very interesting point that he was looking at that problem also almost like a research problem, because he was trying to collect information, trying to analyze, rather than coming to a conclusion. So we went together to one of the leading newspaper editor to understand how the societal forces work. There was a police officer of the very high rank from Mumbai who came, and there was discussion. And it was suggested that you write that there are outside students, and because they are there, the girls may feel threatened, and that is the problem you have here. You just write that. He said that I'll take care of everything. JBJ said, no, that is unethical, because it's untrue. The students are troubling, yes, there is agitation, yes, and we have to face some difficult time, yes, but I will not say that these students are troubling our girls, students here, and they are being threatened. So his ethical stand was even strong, even at the time of that very difficult situation where he had to face the wrath of the student agitation. These are some of the qualities which are quite important for any good administrator, and particularly keeping the ethical stand, keeping the moral stand intact, even at the face of a difficult situation which is coming forward. That is what he kept on doing, and that is what I saw in him. After his retirement from the position of director, I think then he got double the energy, and then he started working on the research projects which were more useful, more helpful to the nation, to the society. The research which he has done in BARC, Bhabha Kavach, we were told in the morning, is a very important research project. Such research projects, projects which are helpful to the society as far as research is concerned, the continuous cooker, the different version of chulha, all these things, they came up after his retirement. So his real contribution, more important contribution in my opinion, started after he retired from that position and devoted all his time, energy, everything for the research for the society. So this is all I wanted to put forward, that he has a different aspect like this. And on behalf of all of you, I wish him a very long and healthy life ahead, and more successes in all such research activities. Thank you.
We are now going to listen to a different personality, Shirish Patel, a civil engineer with a wide range of interests. I think Kishore Mariwala probably brought him to J B Joshi. Am I right? His interests include solar energy and energy conservation, in particularly urban affairs. He was one of the three authors of the idea of New Bombay. I tell you, this is very remarkable, because New Bombay has made a big difference to Old Bombay, you know. When the government of Maharashtra accepted the idea and set up CIDCO, he was put in charge of planning, design and implementation of the new city, a position from which he resigned 5 years later because he felt the project lacked the political support it needed for vigorous implementation. It's not an unusual situation of politicians not agreeing. Shirish, welcome.
Friends, I first met JBJ, as some of us affectionately call him, in 1992, 27 years ago. I had developed quite a successful solar cooker called Surya Kund, a single family 5-liter cooker, and we'd sold about 1,000 pieces. Then we got a request from Kenya for a 15-liter cooker. I was taken aback that African families ate three times as much as Indian families. Then I was told that what happens is a housewife cooks and three or four neighbors drop in for dinner, and the next wife, another housewife cooks, and so on around the circle of friends. So our 5-liter cooker had to be scaled up to 15 liters. The problem was that the solar energy collecting area goes up as the square of the linear dimension, whereas the target, which is the cooking volume, goes up as the cube. So the target becomes smaller in relation to the solar aperture, and too many sun's rays miss the target. This called for fresh research. Capturing solar energy has three major aspects. One is optics, which involves tracking the sun, and if necessary, reflecting rays accurately onto the target. The second is heat transfer. And the third is surface coating materials, which are required to have special qualities, such as high reflectivity, resistance to ultraviolet light, or sometimes a black surface which needs high absorptivity and low emissivity of black body radiation. Of these three, heat transfer and surface materials are aspects of chemical engineering. And of course, cooking itself is a chemical process where I believe JBJ is an expert. But only optics is different and lies outside the field. My friend Kishore Mariwala had been telling me for years that I should meet the professors at UDCT, as it then was. So finally, he and I called on JBJ and Anirudh Pandit. They got quite excited when they heard that 40% of India's daily consumption of energy goes in cooking. That was in 1992, but I'm not sure it's very much less now. A great deal of energy consumed daily between the formal and informal fuels goes in cooking. That was the start of an energy conservation group that met regularly for 2 or 3 hours in the morning, once a fortnight, for 25 years. We were supervising master's and PhD students' research work in energy conservation. For me, the most remarkable thing about this collaboration was how effortlessly both JBJ and Anirudh Pandit moved into the world of optics and the sun's movement. Nothing could be further removed from chemistry and chemical engineering. But armed with first principles and basic mathematics, formal discipline boundaries are neither here nor there, as these two great minds emphatically demonstrated. The other remarkable thing about these fortnightly meetings was the feeling of absolute intellectual equality of all those present. From the senior members, including JBJ and Anirudh Pandit, including all of us members in the same age group or older, each person a leader in his own particular profession, down to the junior-most fresh graduate joining the group, all were equal and heard with the same patience and respect that applies to everyone else. It was truly a meeting of several minds coming together to address a particular problem, with no inhibitions of hierarchy or forced awareness of status. It was JBJ, with his openness and candor, who created this zero ego situation. And I think the ability to create that kind of atmosphere is at the heart of true democracy. Beyond technical ability, beyond expertise, beyond, I would think, even visionary thinking, all of which are present, it is this fundamental spirit of intellectual equality that can produce the strongest teamwork and deliver the most outstanding results. I wish JBJ many more years of productive work. Thank you.
I now have pleasure of bringing to you Percy Kavasmanik, Dr. Percy Kavasmanik, classmate of JBJ, a great orator. While he was in ICT, he used to take part in debates. Percy, I think my memory is not bad, no? He then went to Stanford, did his master's and PhD there, and he rose to fairly high position in Union Carbide. Then Union Carbide got merged with Dow. He's taken great interest in responsible care in chemical industry. After his long 50-year stay in US, he's back in his uncle's Garda's company as deputy managing director and bringing in some systems in GCPL, Garda Chemicals Private Limited, you know. Percy, floor is yours.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, Dr. Kakkar, Professor Yadav, and guests, friends. Few things give me more pleasure than to celebrate the Parsi New Year's Day, than to accept an invitation. Thank you. To reminisce the 70th birthday celebration of my friend Jeshtara Joshi. I've heard others call him JB and JBJ and Professor Joshi, but I've always called him Jeshtaraj, and I hope I'll be able to continue that for many years to come. Our paths first crossed over 52 years ago when we met as students of the first year chemical engineering class of UDCT, now ICT, in 1967. From the moment we met, I could not but help notice this quiet, gentle, unassuming student who exuded confidence and was overflowing with brilliance. While Jeshtaraj came from a small town in Satara, and I was a Bombay boy, and while he lived with his relatives for the first 3 years and then in the hostel at UDCT in his final year, and I would walk through Five Gardens and customs quarters and through VJTI to get to UDCT every day, we soon realized we had more things in common than that which set us apart. True, right from then, he was an undisputed scientist, an engineer, an intellectual. Well, I was voted class representative in the third year and then became chairman of the Technological Association, the UDCT student body, in the final year. During those years, those 4 years, we admired each other. We supported each other. We respected each other. We worked together and we ate together in the canteen. And out of that developed a friendship that would last for over two generations. But I must confess that deep down, I had a feeling that one day he would be doing something great. But at that time, I could not really imagine or have guessed the enormity of his success. Soon the time came for us to graduate, get married. I got married to Aban, whom I'd met in high school, and we traveled to California, and I did my PhD at Stanford. And Jeshtaraj and Rajutha got married the following year, and he stayed to do his PhD under Professor Sharma, and then finally went to Pittsburgh to get his postdoc done. And for some years, we lost touch with each other, except on one occasion, I think, that Jeshtaraj did call me from Pittsburgh to say that he was returning back to India. Many years passed. Fast forward to 5 years ago, it was again Jeshtaraj who called me when I was visiting Mumbai from the US to visit my uncle, Dr. Garda, and he suggested we get together. In fact, he went one step further. He said he was inviting our classmates and their wives at Rujuta and his house. And I had not seen these friends of mine for over 40 years. It was then that I learned that Jeshtharad had just been awarded the Padmabhusan. This was around 2014, I believe. And that he had retired as the director of UDCT in 2009. And now he was doing great things with the atomic energy program. I had learned also at that time that with his usual quiet demeanor, he was able to secure funding from industry to support many very visible changes, not just to the physical landscape of ICT, but to its curriculum and to its reputation. While I knew that he was always destined to do great things, I could not have imagined that my classmate and my friend would have joined the ranks of former UDCT directors like Dr. Naber and Dr. Kane and Professor Sharma and Eraj Daruwala and many other stalwarts in our field to lead the very institution where we first met 52 years ago. Following our first reunion, whenever I visited Mumbai from the US, Jeshtharaj would organize get-togethers with some of our classmates. And my wife and I were thrilled to see how successful all of us had been in our careers and in our personal lives. But Jeshtharaj had now become our class leader, our class representative or organizer, and he embodied the best of our humble beginnings in 1967. Those small acts of kindness to each other were never to be forgotten. It was plain to see he cared not just for his classmates, but for his students, his profession, his alma mater, and his passion for spreading science to the common man. Give Jeshtharaj any problem, and he sees an opportunity to innovate, optimize, and to make the process more efficient. No wonder he is so greatly sought after and admired, as we have heard all day today, for his innovation and creativity. A respected stalwart in his field, not only in India, but all around the world. On a personal note, he was one of the major drivers for me returning to India. And Jeshtharaj and I have now shared many happy moments together on the foundation of Garda Chemicals or together at social events with our wives. Despite his success and his stellar accomplishments, Jeshtharaj remains the same quiet, purposeful, brilliant, and honest scientist that I have known for over 50 years. But what I admire most about him is his sincerity, his honesty, his willingness to help others, never outwardly displaying his prowess to accomplish difficult tasks, but with great humility, giving of himself to better the lives of others. I am proud to call Jeshtharaj my friend, my old friend. We were both born the same month and the same year, both sharing a very special bond which caused us to renew our ties after all these years, and a bond that grows stronger with each passing year. My wife Aban and I wish Jeshtharaj long life, good health, continued great success and happiness with Rujuta and his family for many more years to come. Happy birthday, my friend.
You know, his kids were a bit of an eyesore in the society. They were such outperformers that some of the neighbors were jealous in Charleston.
they get their brains from their mother.
Oh, you are too modest. Not to go on. Your genes being transferred. Congratulations. Very nice. You know, classmate is a classmate, is a lifetime classmate. Here is the
memento.
Your debating remains intact. Is Kiki all right? Huh?
Yes.
I present to you now a great personality who is occupying a pivotal position in India, Sri K. N. Vyas, who is Secretary to Department of Atomic Energy and Chairman Atomic Energy Commission. Nice to have the previous chairman here, Anil Kakodkar. I think Banerjee had to go away. He's a mechanical engineer from MS University, Baroda. He has also served as Director of BARC prior to his current position. He has been conferred several awards, which include Indian Nuclear Society Outstanding Service Award in 2011, Homi Science and Technology Award 2006.
Respected Joshi sir is not here, but Joshi sir, Kakodkar sir, Madam Kakodkar, Madam Joshi, great people present here. To tell you frankly, I met Professor Joshi only when I became Director of BRC, but before that, I had a chance to meet Professor Joshi. I picked up one thing from him. He was full of go into nitty gritty, but I could see the positivity in him, and I could see that any problem you pose to him, he will be in a small town called Bardoli, OIC, and he said that he would like to sort of give back to the students who are performing well, attempt whatsoever possible to give back to the society. So in my very short interaction which I had, many a times the interaction lasted only for an hour or maybe half an hour or so. These are the two takeaways I would take from him, and I would certainly try to follow to whatever extent I have learned from him. Another thing I would just like to mention about, not about Professor Joshi, but about Marathi Vigyan Parishad. See, generally, I belong to Gujarat. In Gujarat, people are more worried about earning money rather than, I would say, certain finer aspects of these things. Maybe, I would say, the classical music or maybe... So many a times I used to feel when I used to listen to some of the lectures. See, basically, mala Marathit bolaychi savai nahit, but mi samjhu shakto, pushkar barabar samjhu shakto. But when I heard Professor Narlikar, you will speak for hours together, but not a single word of English in this. I have seen even Dr. Kakodkar also say, so I feel the nurturing which is done of the society by such great people, and this is what has made this Marathi Vigyan Parishad to continue and excel. So I'm extremely grateful that, I mean, I would say the amount of thing which I have learned by sitting just for about more than about a couple of hours sitting here, it is more than what I have learned possibly in last about, I would say, last 6 months or so. So I'm extremely humbled by being present here, by today's exposure to the work which has done by which has been done by Professor Joshi. Thank you, sir. And I'm indeed honored that I have been allowed to come and speak a few words here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, house is full. That only shows the esteem in which JBJ is held. Now you're going to listen from some very special person, and that is Rujuta, who would know many secrets of JBJ which none of us know. And she's the real backbone, because I have seen, in fact, sometimes to remind him about certain assignments, Rujuta plays a role, because in his busy, you know, a lot of engagement, JB might forget something, you know. Not the equation or the technical matter, but something besides that. So Rujuta, tell us something which we don't know.
Only you can know that.
Hello, namaste. I would like to thank Atomic Energy Commission and Marathi Vidyan Parishad and all volunteers for organizing such a nice function. This is my first speech in my life of 64 years. I am proud of JB, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank for him for such a wonderful and happy married life of 41 years. He's sincere, soft-spoken, and strict, but kind-hearted. After marriage, we went to America for 1 year, and there we have fruitful discussions, and we started understanding each other very well. His kind nature helped me doing household chores, which I was used to do before marriage, because I was not knowing even cooking nicely. He always ate whatever I cook happily in the starting. In his busy schedule, he has always made it a point to have quality time for his family and his friends. We always go out for movie, Marathi play, and a vacation together with family and extended family, always. We together have visited many nations in the world, as well as many places in India, till we enjoy drinking tea together anywhere, both of us. He was playing with Aniruddha, our son, bad ball, carom, ludo, cards, and now he plays with grandchildren as Abba. Both the girls enjoying playing with him very nicely. He's a thorough professor. He was teaching while he was doing master's and PhD. After our marriage, he was telling me that all my students are our children. But at that time, I was opposing him, because some of his students you have seen maybe that nearly of my age, and how could they be my children? But after 20 years, when our son Aniruddha went to college, I said, okay, now your students can be our children, because they are all now Aniruddha's age. And I want to tell you one amazing story. When JB was coming from his lectures, I used to ask him, how was your day and how was your lecture or something like that. He always used to tell me that lecture was fine, excellent, good, and something like that. Once I took opportunity to attend his lecture at a conference in Melbourne. He started his plenary lecture, and I saw around and noted that some of the attending audience was sleeping. I took some pictures and captured that much only. In the evening, I again asked him, how was your day? He, as usual, he said, very good. And I showed him the pictures. And we had heartiest laugh together. An interesting part, he said later on, that those scientists, some of them who were sleeping, were asking more questions than others. I once again thank you to Atomic Energy, Marathi Vidyan, and give me this opportunity to refresh our memories. Thank you.
Next to you.
Yes. Very nice one. He always takes memento.
Thank you, Rajita. We now have Professor B. N. Jagtap, who is a senior faculty member in the Department of Physics, IIT Bombay. Until 2016, he served as Distinguished Scientist and Director of Chemistry Group of BARC. His research areas include laser physics and technology, quantum optics, laser-cooled atoms, nanophotonics, and development of societal and industrial technologies. For the last 3 years, he has been working with non-agricultural universities of Maharashtra to orient higher education in the state to meet the contemporary challenges and expectations. I dare say it must be a pretty tough task, the last one.
Thank you, Professor Sharma. Mrs. Joshi, Professor J B Joshi, Dr. Kakodkar, Mr. Vyas, Dr. Jiri Yadav. Thank you very much for giving me this privilege of adding my words of appreciation and felicitation to Professor Joshi. I first met Professor Joshi sometime in 2011. Of course, I had delayed it by almost 3.5 decades. Once I told him this, and this audience may not know, I studied in Ruya College, and the aim of every Ruyaite was to land up in UDCT. So in early 70s, I took admission in UDCT and studied there for 3 weeks. But that Professor Sharma was director at that time. But that bug of doing basic research had bitten me thoroughly, so I discontinued and did basic sciences degree and joined BARC. Later in 2016, I told Professor Joshi that, look, I am also an ICT alumni. And there he said, well, you should be at least given the associate membership of ICT Alumni Association. So I smiled. My interaction grew with him in 2013 when I was appointed director of chemistry group, BRC. And it was a real difficult time for me. The first one was my background happened to be lasers, photonics, playing with wave functions and lasers and laser technology. So I was in a different game. The second one was, the chemistry group is a very competent group in VRC, very prolific publishing group. And by that time, I had nurtured some ideas that, which I shared with Professor Joshi, is that our research should end up in doing something useful. So can we translate our publications One place I will differ is that societal technologies need not be at the primitive science level. They can be high tech. Only thing one needs to see that they are simple enough. So I used to chide my colleagues in chemistry group that, look, what you are doing is dancing in the dark. And this, some of my colleagues are here and they will very well recollect this, that we do great research. And this is like a dancer who has closed the doors, closed the windows, closed the lights, he's dancing. He comes out and says, I'm a great dancer. The best way to do it is open the windows, open the doors, have full light, dance, let others assess. So I wanted to remove that dancing in the dark syndrome, and I was looking for a mentor. And then I approached Professor Joshi. I said, look, this group is extremely competent. And everything what they have done, whatever publications they have done, at least 10%, I can see prospect of 50% converting into products, technologies, devices. I need a mentor. And as usual, he said, yes, that's also is my dream. And we joined hands together. And next 4 years were just wonderful years for the chemistry group. The kind of subjects we handled, right from gallium to red mud to water technologies to catalyst developments, so many things, including we attempted to do the flow accelerator corrosion. Somehow we did not proceed because of some certain administrative problems. And during that period, thanks to his efforts and efforts of my colleagues in the chemistry group, every 2 months we were transferring a technology. It was a great feat. I mean, from a group which was prolific in publishing papers, we could convert into a group while retaining the basic sciences character into a group which could deliver in a big way. And everything that could be possible because of his association, we used to call him that he's an honorary member of chemistry group. And chemistry group had one wonderful thing. Every year we used to have the annual reviews with the 3 external members, and he used to be the 4th member, so that one could see the opportunities, what can be derived from the research that is being done. This connectivity, these contacts, then extended into the scientific social life, and that is one place where he was president of Marathi Vigyan Parishad, and he wanted to have a really a big function, the annual gathering. There were certain issues. He wanted to do it in Anushakti Nagar. There were certain administrative issues. He spoke to me. I said, don't worry, these are very simple things to do. That time I was also the president of the Marathi Bhasha Parishad of BRC. So I proposed that this Bhasha Parishad will do all the administrative things, because it is an official body in BRC. And then we joined hands together, and that was just a wonderful function that we had in Anushakti Nagar. And many of you may not know that hall, the big convention center, was not ready, and we wanted to inaugurate it there, and also the next day have Chief Minister of Maharashtra there. And it was really hectic time. He used all his contacts. We got NOCs, occupancy certificate. We did it. And later, I must tell you, after 6 months, they withdrew that occupancy certificate. And we also had the privilege of felicitating him as a part of Marathi Bhasha Parishad's Marathi Day. Usually, the Bhasha Parishad would honor one person from the social sphere and one from the science sphere. And he was selected on one occasion. And I still remember the announcement you did on that day. I think Sindhutai Sakpal was another invitee. And he said that, look, I'm going to get Maharashtra Bhushan. I don't know what is the what is the money part of that award. But if it is 5 lakhs, I'll give 5 lakhs to Sindhutai Sakpar. And if it is not 5 lakhs, I'll add money, make it 5 lakhs, and give it to Sindhutai Sakpar. So that was a great occasion. And of course, I had witnessed this kind of a gathering one more time when he was felicitated at Brevon Stadium receiving Padmabhusan. Friends, there is one thing I must say, which is not what others have said so far. If you come in contact with Professor Joshi, you're always in that contact. You're always in that circle. I left BRC, joined IIT. Just to give you an example, last year he called me. Oh, you're doing a wonderful job with the government of Maharashtra and universities in Maharashtra. I said, who told you? I have not spoken to anybody so far. I'm doing it very secretly. Only the university people know about it. No, 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 I heard it from so-and-so. I said, yeah, he has been with me taking rounds in the universities. He wanted to know something more about it. I said, yes, I'm doing very little. It is not something great. And it is all that you taught us. Now I'm developing a different relationship with him, and which we practiced in chemistry group for 4 years. And that is exactly what Herbert Spencer has made a statement on that. The grand aim of education is not knowledge, but action. And what has been missing in our academic circuits is that action part of it. So you don't need big policies to correct the education system, but you just need to put an action, whether it's in the social sphere, whether it's scientific circle, whether it's technological spheres, and that is what is the solution. Well, he said, you will succeed. I said, yes, with your blessings, I'll certainly succeed. And now something which made me really very sensitive. I'm a very, very hard person, never feel very emotional. I retired on 31st December 2016. That was Saturday. IIT had said you join anytime. So I said, why do I join on 1st January, which was Sunday? Let me be in no man's land on that day and join on 2nd of January. And on that day, I had a retrospective view of what I had done so far. And I thought, when I'm joining a new institute, I should clean my slate. So I took a day to clean my slate. And next day I joined, and in the afternoon I was in the classroom. I said, now I'm a different person. After 15 days, about so, got a call from Professor Joshi. How are you doing? It struck me. I said, I'm doing fine. And jokingly, I said, look, I'm doing something what Bernard Shaw said. Those who can do, those who cannot teach. So I'm no longer good enough for doing. That's what is the retirement is. So I'm teaching now. He said, look, tomorrow I'm going to visit IIT. I would like to see you there. I looked at my clean slate. I thought I had cleaned it, but there were still some impressions which were unerasable, and that was Professor Joshi. Next day, he came. I said that, look, the lift of that building is somewhere in between. You will find it difficult, so I'll come and receive you at the ground floor. Just give me a call when you come to IIT Bombay. And then at 10:30, there was a knock on my door. We had climbed 2 stairs, and he was in my room. We chatted for half an hour, and then he asked me, what do you teach? I said, quantum physics and quantum optics. And then there was that sign of disapproval. he probably doesn't like quantum physics. And then he said, look, I'm going to meet my friends in chemical engineering group, chemical engineering division. So I said, yes, let's go there. There is a tea pantry, we'll have a coffee there. So I went along with him. And Well, for the physics and chemistry people, I was not a new person in IIT, but I was a new animal for the chemical engineering people. So he introduced me to those chemical engineers. And the way he introduced them is Professor Jagtap is a scientist by training, but he's an engineer. Well, that was the best compliment I have ever got in my life. But I didn't ask him what was he meaning by that. Later sometime, I realized what he meant. And that advice I'm using with my students. And what does that mean is that, what is the difference between an engineer and a scientist? A scientist is a researcher, but he throws out his results for others. Whereas an engineer looks for an opportunity in his research. And that opportunism, in positive sense, makes you an engineer. And this is what I thought, Professor Sharma, that this is a DNA of ICT. That, and which is include, and therefore, my students who learn quantum physics, they want to turn and they say, oh, we would like to do physics as a subject, we want to change. I said, don't do that. You need to be a physicist and you need to be an opportunist. Use that physics to develop some new technologies. So thank you, Professor Joshi, for being part of our academic life and enriching it. At the same time, if you think that I have learned, which I would have learned in ICT in the first 4 years, which I learned in the last 4 years at BRC with you, if that is good enough, I am ready to accept that associate membership of ICT Alumni Association, if that offer still exists. Thank you very much. And on behalf of the chemistry group, BRC, and also my, now I can say on behalf of IIT Bombay, I wish you every best. Thank you very much.
Well, we have come to the last speaker, formidable personality called Ganpati Dada Yadav, popularly called Yogesh. How should I describe him? Once I had said he is a nuclear reactor because he's busy all the time. And he has an eye for perfection, even signboards, they must be in the right direction, right design. But I take you back to somewhere in 1972. He was a hostelite, sportsman. I once reminded him, I think I had seen him playing volleyball in the hostel because I was in the staff quarters. Then he joined for master's, did PhD, and many of you won't know that he's the first person in India to work on phase transfer catalysis long before organic chemists, eminent organic chemists of India thought of it. And since we have been continuously talking about DNA of UDCT, before his thesis was submitted, already commercialization took place of using those phase transfer catalysis. JB was able to, they are all extraordinary fund collectors. JB collected a lot of money. G.D. Yadav has collected tons of money. JB got money to build the six-story hostel, which was always a chronic problem because I suffered in 1958, couldn't get hostel accommodation. So I was always nursing this grievance that graduate students didn't have hostel accommodation. G.D. Yadav lived in Churchgate. Why? If you live in campus, you can work for long hours. And GD has been collecting money in an exponential way. So he has, the deemed university came with JB after a lot of hard and sustained work. But GD has done something greater, because it's very difficult to move so-called government of Maharashtra to confer any special status except on politicians themselves, you know. So this elite status recognized by government of Maharashtra and giving IIT status so that faculty member can retire at 65. Remember, Institute of Science, government's own institution, they are retire off at 58. Institute of Science fellows retired 58, what a pity, but ICT got that great privilege. He has been an outstanding vice-chancellor of ICT. He has many positions, adjunct positions, but he's a tireless worker. I don't know whether he sleeps. I have no idea, but I'm sure he gets up at 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And then there's a lot of he's active in his research. So many people say, how can you do research? You are a director, you are a vice chancellor. I say, depends from personality to personality. So our day before the formal felicitation function begins, you have an outstanding personality in GDY.
Professor Jeshtaraj Joshi, Mrs. Rujita Joshi, Professor M.M. Sharma, Dr. Kakodkar, Sri Vyas, many of Professor Joshi's well-wishers, friends, students, classmates, my own colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. At the very outset, let me wish Professor Joshi, on behalf of all of us at ICT, this faculty, students, support staff, and alumni, a very, very long life, as they say in Sanskrit, Jivet Sharada Shatam. Long live JB, because I know you, since the day you came to the hostel, old hostel, and used to stay in a bigger room called L1 on first floor. And you had classmates like V.V. Mahajani in room number 96, then Vidyadhar Paranjpe, M.M. Masurkar, and of course, I knew Percy Kawasmanik because he was the chairman of Technological Association and he was a very good hockey player. I know that also. Very good hockey player because I myself played hockey for some time. So I know you since then. And so many things have been told about you, your personality. But I will add something to that. We used to say that, you know, Professor Joshi used to work on these big vessels. So jokingly used to say, J.B. Joshi reactor la adava jhopavtat. He used to have horizontal contactor, spot contactor, and he used to measure the overall mass transfer coefficient, liquid side, KLA, and gas side, KGA. So that KLA stands, J.B., for you, kindness, lovable and accessible to everybody. That is the KLA for me. And the KGA is knowledgeable, great, and angel-like. So you are angel-like. That is why so many people have come here for your felicitation on the occasion of your 70th birthday. I have known you many things about you, known you as a student, and you taught us. You taught us When we were in third year, you were already a research student, so you have taken lessons in stoichiometry. I remember that Professor Sharma had given you that opportunity. Then you taught me during master's the process control. And I still remember you used to draw very nice Bode diagrams, very beautiful diagrams. So I remember. And one thing you may not notice, but I can tell you the secret. You never said and, you always said ani. So X and Y, and you never said. You say X and Y. So this, I remember since the day you taught, and it was very interesting because that is a Marathi version of. So X and I, you never say X and Y. So this is JB. But apart from his qualities, which you mentioned all along, what he has left for ICT, where the history will remember you forever, is for getting this deemed university status. And I remember we went together to MHRD on that particular day, 12th September 2008, and we got that letter. And we were so happy. And we came to CSR guest house, and Professor Sharma was there in that room. And we went and gave that letter to him and said, sir, here is our deemed university status. And he had literally tears in his eyes because he knows the value. And he has been always saying about getting this deemed university status. So you gave me things on platter. So if I have succeeded, I would not have been able to do anything but for the deemed university status and getting that converted into the so-called, elite status and center of excellence where IIT-like treatment. But my real dream is just not that. I think we should be a central institute, and your blessing will still work because Dr. Kakodkar is here. And in that particular GR, which was, of course, the assembly, when this was presented, I was called to the assembly. They said, the government of Maharashtra will help us in getting funds from center, etc. So now is the time we should get the central recognition as central institute. And that is what Professor Sharma also desires. And I'm sure on this particular occasion, I hope my words become true that we should get it sooner than later. So this expansion of UDCT, ICT to three campuses, perhaps we may go to Mauritius also because the government has offered us that particular thing. So imagine if you had not done that, none of these things would have been possible. So I'm a grateful person. I believe the gratitude must be expressed publicly in front of everybody that so-and-so did it, and therefore we are beneficiaries of that. And so history will be written forever that Professor Joshi brought that autonomy. He was troubled by so many people. People have narrated that. That is history. Nobody will remember that, but everybody will remember you for getting us that deemed university status, which allowed us to go. And now we can compare ourselves with IITs. So our per capita performance are the so-called normalized citation impact or weighted citation impact is as good as IISc Bangalore. And we are in top three in the country in terms of all branches. So I think that particular gift you have given to us by your foresight. And so that is the greatest contribution. All other things, you are loving, you are very nice, and your wife said the people were sleeping during your lecture. That is interesting. But you have awakened the nation and given this gift to ICT, which we can never forget. At least one for myself, I will never forget that, what it did to ICT. And now, I still remember, once you told me, I do not know whether you remember, you said that you would like to work forever. I do not want to retire. I want to do it. I remember that word, and I said, you will be professor for life, emeritus professor of eminence. So he's a professor. He will work all his life. I'm sure that madam will not like it, but he has to teach. And still he comes and teaches, the students the BTEC students particularly, multi-phase reactors and all. So I think that is his love and affection for ICD. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to take much of your time, but I would say this, that JB has done everything in his humility. He's very simple. He's modest in his achievements. So when I had a time of some time back, I wanted to introduce him to some audience, a big conference. And when I looked at his CV, I said, "Why? Who has written this?" I asked him, "Why they are not mentioning your contributions to UDCT? They are just talking about your Homi Baba professor. That is fine. But what about your contributions to UDCT, ICT? I felt it myself. I said, that should have been given in golden letters. So on this particular day, on behalf of the Institute of Chemical Technology, on my behalf, as a student, as colleague, and also successor to you, and on all behalf of you, I wish him many more active years. And I said in the beginning, Jeevet Sharada Shatam. Once again, I say, Jeevet Sharada Shakam. Thank you.
Happy person. I'm privileged to hand over mementos to my former collaborators. Well, thank you all the speakers. We have overshot the time a bit, but the occasion demanded no restriction on timings on the speakers, so it's come out tolerably well. I thank all of you for being vigilant and being quiet listeners to the encomiums great J.B. Joshi has got. Thank you.
I request Deshpande sir to offer a token of love. Hello, sir. Dry fruits packets to M.M. Sharma, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for chairing the session. Deshpande sir, would you like to read some message, I think?
There is one message that actually Dr. Kakodkar has received, but I am asked to read it out. This is from Kamachi Mudali, CEO, Heavy Water Board, and that I am reading. I am reading it many times. You know, in the olden days, in the post office, there used to be one writer. So those who were unable to read and write, they used to dictate to that particular writer. And he used to write. There used to be an umpteen number of jokes. The fellow who used to say to that fellow that my handwriting is bad, so don't laugh. Now, whose handwriting? Similarly, I am reading. If there are any mistakes, pardon me, they are not the original writers. My association with Professor J. B. Joshi has been long-standing for more than a decade. It was during the period of Dr. Baldev Raj as Director IGCAR that Professor Joshi was first introduced to our center. Professor Joshi was then Director of ICT Mumbai. A two-day interaction between the senior colleagues of the center and a team of faculty members from ICT, headed by Professor Joshi, was organized. Many challenging issues in the entire gamut of FBR fuel cycle technology was identified and presented to them for a fruitful collaboration. Professor Joshi understood the importance of FBR technology, fast breeder reactor, FBR technology towards the long-term energy security of the country and came forward with all his colleagues in solving the identified issues with their expertise. Many of these challenges were converted to PhD program under the guidance of the experts from both IGCR and ICT. This great idea of his sensitized many youngsters towards nation building. Some of my own colleagues had been fortunate enough to choose the problems of their choice and become a research student under the able guidance of Professor Joshi himself. They went on to overcome many challenges and complete their PhD with good distinctions. My association with him was primarily for solving some of the key challenges in the FBR spent fuel reprocessing technology when I was heading the reprocessing R&D division of IGCR. The importance of the development of the continuous dissolution system of FBR fuel reprocessing technology has been well documented. As this is a gas liquid solid phenomenon, it was well within the domain of the expertise of Professor Joshi. The primary data required for the development of this is the intrinsic dissolution kinetics of the fuel of our interest. Couple of my colleagues was identified to address this and were registered for PhD under his guidance in the aegis of HBNI. The chemistry of dissolution of PU-rich FBR fuel has been studied systematically through experimental and modeling work under the careful supervision of Professor Joshi and is well established as on date. Solvent extraction in the fundamental process through which spent nuclear fuel are processed for the recovery of the fissile materials in the reprocessing plant. Some of the process information like the extraction kinetics of the species of our interest were not available in the open literature, which is the basic data required for the design of the solvent extraction contactors employed for this. Professor Joshi had vividly foreseen this relevance and guided some of the senior colleagues of our division in understanding and establishing the solvent extraction kinetics of the species of our interest like nitric acid, UIV, etc. in the Purex solvent, tri-N-butyl phosphate TBP. The result was the fine-tuned process flow sheets that were designed, reviewed, demonstrated, and approved for DFRP and FRFCF reprocessing plants. Once the solvent extraction behavior of this species of our interest is well understood, the subsequent challenge was finalized, the design of the centrifugal extractors, which is the workhorse of FBR fuel reprocessing plant. Continuing the contribution of Dr. S.B. Cognati, Professor Joshi guided a couple of young officers in IGCR for understanding the complete behavior of CE with experimental and computational fluid dynamics simulation studies. This helped in designing of suitably sized CEs for DFRP and FRFCE reprocessing plants in IGCR, which are under construction now. Professor Joshi has always been a very simple and a thought-provoking personality. He has been Acharya Patra of ideas for the colleagues of IGCR who had the opportunity of interact with him. Every interaction with him ends up in improving the understanding level of the person discussing with him. I have had first-hand experience in observing how the thinking ability of some of my colleagues had shaped up in the right direction during the course of their prolonged technical discussions with Professor Joshi. Gradually, some of my junior colleagues who did their PhD under his guidance had become self-reliant in the performing of their technical tasks. Many a times I had the opportunity to witness how Professor Joshi reviews the progress of the PhD of some of my junior colleagues. It is always a win-win situation. The beneficiary list of IGCR as a result of interaction with Professor Joshi, did not stop with reprocessing group alone. As they say, knowledge is infectious. The technical capability of Professor Joshi, which is par excellence, were rubbed onto my colleagues from the reactor design group of IGCR as well. Professor Joshi has played a critical role in assessing the cavitation risk of primary sodium pumps in PFBR. Towards this, he personally visited KBL in Kirloskarwadi, Pune, where the full-scale pump was water tested. He guided IGCR engineers in the computation of flow and pressure distribution in the pump. He also proposed a methodology to predict the potential of turbulent eddies in damaging the impellers. This study, along with other similar studies, led to modification in the pump suction, elevating the risk of cavitation damage. There were also similar such contributions of Professor Joshi in the fast reactor technology group of IGCR. The list is never ending as it continues to offer his expertise in overcoming many challenges in IGCR. The contribution of Professor Joshi towards the betterment of FBR fuel technology in IGCR is beyond appreciation. The list goes on endlessly if one has to do justice to spell out his total contribution. Many individuals, including me, have been impressed upon his tireless commitment. Age has been a mere number for him, as he still continues to contribute for the nation building when many of his contemporaries have retired. Professor Joshi has been a great mentor to many individuals. I would like to summarize his life as follows. Professor Joshi, through his sheer knowledge, mastered the subject of his education. He then skillfully engineered his knowledge to practical solution, mentored his followers up to about three generations, and addressed many challenges for social benefit. So he is one of the great sons of this soil. I and many of my colleagues from IGCR owe a lot of debt to him for his contribution. The best possible tribute that I can think of on behalf of my IGCR colleagues to Professor Joshi is successfully launched the FBR technology and to secure the long-term energy security of the country. Thank you.
A good friend to many, responsible, loving husband of Rujuta ma'am, loving, caring father and grandpa, respectable and affectionate guru to hundreds of students of several universities, and top of everything, very, very pleasant personality. So we have legend amongst us, Professor J B Joshi, to whom we are going to felicitate in some more time. But before that, we are going to have his book launch program. We have heard about this multifaceted person throughout the day, yet I'll talk officially about his career. Professor Joshi sir started his career in 1972 as joining faculty of the University Department of Chemical Technology, UDCT, presently known as ICT. He worked there for most of his career in various positions and retired as its director in 2009. After that, he joined Homi Bhabha Chair Professor in Homi Bhabha National Institute, Department of Atomic Energy. Presently, he is working as Emeritus Professor in DAE as well as in ICT. Sir is credited with efforts on dissemination of knowledge. Through over 500 scientific papers, he has published in peer-reviewed journals with over 18,000 citations. Chemical Technology Journal USA has recommended his procedure 5 times during 1999 and 2000. At the Institute of Chemical Technology, he organized around 200 science workshops. He successfully upgraded the institute to the status of deemed university, which is now ranked among the top 10 in the world. He's one of the key persons in getting the funds for research by way of donations, research contracts, project consultancies. Professor Joshi is widely respected as a mentor, teacher, and he has successfully guided more than 100 doctoral students. Professor Joshi, sir, and Dr. A.K. Nayak, sir, have edited the book, Advances in Computational Fluid Dynamics in Nuclear Reactor Design and Safety. Dr. Arun Kumar Nayak, the co-editor of this book, is a nuclear scientist in BRC, professor in HBNI. He is a PhD in nuclear engineering from Tokyo Institute of Technology, Japan. He is well known for advanced nuclear reactor designs with passive safety systems and has specialization in nuclear reactor thermal hydraulics and safety. Advanced heavy water reactor design is one of his significant contributions. He has received multiple awards and prizes throughout his career and published over 350 peer-reviewed articles and served as editor and guest editors for several international journals. May I request Nayak sir to come on the dais, please? Nayak sir, please. We welcome you, sir. May I request Dr. Sapna ma'am to welcome him with a flower bouquet. I request Dr. Nayak to speak about the book.
Respected Professor Sharma, respected Madam and Professor J B Joshi, respected Madam and Dr. Kakodkar sir, Chairman Atomic Energy Commission, Dr. Mahanti, Director Bark, Dr. Grover, Member Atomic Energy Commission, Professor Basudev Rao, VCHBNI, distinguished scientists, engineers, academicians, as well as friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. So while many things we have heard about Professor Joshi, one thing I would like to speak, which Dr. Kakodkar sir mentioned in the morning, but there is a reason behind that. That reason I want to speak. He is one of the persons whom you will feel from inner of your heart of touching his feet without discussions. This is probably not spoken. And this book, Professor Joshi and myself have a short story. Without speaking long about the technical aspects of this book, I will speak about the story behind editing this book. I think it's around 2006 or 7, Dr. R.K. Sinha, he's not here, he was our group director. He wanted to have a DA computer code without using the imported computer codes. That time, Dr. Kakodkar sir was the chairman of Atomic Energy Commission. He wanted a DA code which we did not have. And we had a short meeting, fairly mixed up young and senior level people. And the whole objective was to find out what is happening around the globe and what we should have. The French was driving the code called NURISIM, Nuclear Reactor Simulation. It was one of the state-of-the-art computational code that time, which was integrated code right from reactor physics, thermal hydraulics, structural mechanics, ending with even core degraded accident till what goes to the public. We thought, why not to have a code like that? It was well appreciated that time. And the whole project name was Promegene, project on multi-physics simulation and multi-scale integrated simulation of nuclear reactors. And there was a rule for that co-development. All the people have to be below 35. But I had crossed 35. I was 42 that time. So the rule was only exception for me because I was ruling, I was the team leader. But all others had to be below 35. And the timeline was specified that you have to drive this course. And one of the biggest aspects of that code was developing computational fluid dynamics code, CFD code. And when it was targeted by the top boss, all young people jumped, as you know, that I want to contribute, I want to contribute. But the biggest lacuna in DA setup that time was, let me be very honestly speaking, none of us had really written a code of the structure of a computational fluid dynamics code. So the project was not moving. It was really very, very slow. One fine day, we saw Professor Joshi. He was still working at ICT director. He was brought into Hall 7. And he gave a very beautiful presentation on the state of art computational fluid dynamics. When this presentation he gave, whatever hope I had that we can develop this code, that day I lost it. Because he said, what are the issues on computational fluid dynamics? Even we cannot simulate how a bubble grows, what is the lift force, drag force, and the large uncertainties on that. But anyway, after that, Dr. Sina told that Professor Joshi is going to be our mentor and asked me to work with him. So that was my starting point. It was close to 2009. Then Professor Joshi was inducted to our group. But because of his personality, everybody wanted to be trained on CFD. So he ran a big classroom in HBNI. And we wanted also many PhD students to work with that. At that time, Vishy was Dr. Grover sir. He was very kind enough to put as many PhD students who he wanted on this. We had really Initially, we had plenty of PhD students together working on this. And then what happened? BRC has a funny rule. If people have to come from BRC to attend classes in HBNI, then there is something called the punching time is, you know, as an issue. And the coming and going time is to 1 hour plus lecture time is to 2 hours, 3 hours. Almost 30, 40 people from BRC used to come to HBNI to attend his lectures. Dr. P.K. Vijayan, he was our division head. He used to be very angry on me. 30, 40 people, lot of man hours going. What is the achievement? And in fact, so Professor Joshi, is, as you know, is very kind-hearted. He knows how to handle or bring solutions to solutions. Then he speaks, what do you want? Do you want one apple every day I can give you? If you want one apple in a week, I can give you. If you want one apple in a year, I can also give you. So this way he used to quench the requirement of the department. But what happened, let me tell you. Very soon he asked me, let's not look at everything together. Look at advanced heavyweight reactor. There's the most complex problem. So looking at advanced heavyweight reactor, he started solving, right from what is happening inside the core to several passive safety systems. And believe it or not, in roughly 5 to 7 years, we had plenty of publications in leading journals, it happened. And about 2 years back, we got invitation from Elsevier to write this book. And that book, Elsevier wanted only on passive safety systems, CFD simulation of passive safety systems. Professor Joshi asked me why not to write this book. It's a very good opportunity. Then I looked at why only passive safety system. We have done from this end to that end, right from how a bubble grows to what is happening in a core melt accident. We have done CFD simulations also. Why not to include everything? So he agreed. Then I also looked at, we had, I think during the tenure of Kakodkar sir, that the Indo-UK collaborations had started. So we had strong collaborations with Imperial College London. and that is the birthplace of CFD, we all know. So they all joined. They said, okay, we want to contribute to this book. Then people in IGCAR, they said, why you want to limit only to water-cooled reactor? Let's also contribute on sodium-cooled fast reactor. Then we had a few friends in US also. They said, we want to contribute on molten salt reactor, high-temperature reactors and all. So that saved the border of this book. And in fact, believe it or not, this book we took more than 1.5 years to write. But there was one more requirement that Atomic Energy Department has to give special permission. And Professor Joshi asked me that what should we do? That time, Bashab was Director Bark. So Professor Joshi met him. And he was very kind enough, in one stroke, go ahead. And that is the background of this book. But many of our friends, colleagues, I think there are nearly 50 authors of this book, even though we are the editors, or we are the prime authors of this book. It took roughly 1.5 years. So this book writes not only what is happening for water-cooled reactors, the passive safety systems in general, looking at advanced heavy water reactor design, and also core melt accidents, hydrogen distribution, fire. Some of the experts also are sitting here. They all have contributed. So this is a great occasion, we thought, to launch it. And with kind permission of Professor Joshi, he said, let's launch it on this auspicious day. So that is the background of this book. I thank the organizers for allowing me to speak about this book. Thank you.
It will take just few minutes to arrange the dais for book launch. Just bear with us for not more than 5 minutes.
Thank you.
It's our pleasure to invite a distinguished scientist, well-known nuclear physicist, renowned personality, director BRC, Dr. A.K. Mohanty, sir, for the noble act of a book launch. In his 36 years at BRC, Dr. Mohanty has worked in several areas of nuclear physics, from collision energy to sub-Coulomb barrier and relativistic regime. He has also been a part of some path-breaking experiments at TIFR, the Brookhaven National Laboratory in US, and CERN in Geneva. He has received several honors such as Indian Physical Society's Young Scientist Award, the Indian National Science Academy's Young Physicist Award, and DAE's Homi Bhabha Science and Technology Award. He has twice been conferred the honor of being CERN Scientific Associate in 2004 and 2011. May I request Dr. Mohanty sir to come on the dais. Sir, we welcome you, sir. I request Dr. Sapna to welcome sir with a flower bouquet. I request sir to take charge of the session and to invite a distinguished guest.
Good evening, Professor Joshi, and all the dignitaries present here. I must admit here that, like all of you, I have not been so lucky to work with Professor Joshi directly, although I know him pretty well, an eminent personality who has been associated with the department for last more than 10 years or so. So when I got an invitation to come to this function by Dr. Kakodkar, that I have to be participating in the book launching ceremony, I happily accepted this because it is a rare honor for me to come here and launch this book. So before I invite the dignitaries to this panel, I must say a little bit about the book because I have gone through it. So we all know that the design and safety of nuclear reactors is critically dependent on the ability to extract heat from the reactor core with minimum risk of breach of the safety barriers that are provided to prevent escape of radioactivity. Quantitative understanding of the reactor behavior under potential accident situations is important not only to evaluate the safety margins but also to optimize the design. Thermal hydraulics thus plays an important role in design and safety assessment in nuclear reactors. Historically, design and safety assessment of nuclear reactors have been carried out by 1D computer codes, which makes several assumptions in flow field and empiricism. In this context, developments in computational fluid dynamics have added a great deal of robustness and comprehensive insights in such analysis with minimum uncertainty, despite the complexities in geometry, flow patterns, and regimes involved. In India, developments of a wide variety of nuclear reactors have led to a rich experience in all areas of fluid dynamics and safety analysis that are involved. Some of these designs, like the advanced heavy-water reactor, promise new paradigms like immunity from any serious impact in public domain, achieving high level of safety in societies not equipped with very high-tech infrastructure. Developments of CFD have been very importantly contributed to qualification of such first-of-kind systems over and above strengthening the indigenous capability in design and safety assessment. This book comprehensively covers all aspects of CFD related to different reactor designs involving core heat removal by variety of coolants like water, sodium, salt, gas, etc., multi-phase flows, passive systems, core melts, situations, different containment phenomena, fire, and other things similar to that. The topics have been contributed by specialists in respective fields. The book thus brings together in-depth knowledge and a rich experience for the benefit of students, practitioners, and researchers involved in the use of CFD in nuclear reactor design and safety assessment. I am certain that the readers would be find this book an important contribution to the literature in this field. With these few words, now I invite Dr. Anil Kakodkar, Professor M.M. Sharma, Sri K.N. Vyas, Dr. R.V. Grover, Professor Basudev Rao, and Professor Joshi and Arun Naik to come to the dais.
I request all the dignitaries on the dais to have a book launch. The book is in front of us, and can you please do the honor? Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. Now the dais will be prepared for the felicitation function. Can you please chair tables? Professor Jeshtharaj B. Joshi, sir, who teaches us, grooms us, shows us path of progress. Whoever comes in contact with him automatically feels to bow down with his numerous admirable qualities. We are all gathered here to honor him. Today's most awaited session begins now. What else can be the moment of pride if Joshi sir is honored by his guru himself? On behalf of all of us, I request Professor J B Joshi sir to come on the dais with his guru, Professor M M Sharma sir. May I request Kakodkar sir and Vyas sir to accompany them. I also request Rujuta ma'am to come on the dais. I welcome you all, sir. Have a seat, sir. I request Sharma sir to felicitate Professor Joshi with Puneri Pagdi, which is symbol of scholarship. May I request? Just 2 minutes. They are still preparing something. So let's wait for 1 minute. Shall we start? Okay. Just let me know.
Masur is a village in the Satara district of Maharashtra. It was known by a family that resided here.
So I request Professor this Sharma family, sir to felicitate Joshi sir with Puneri Pagdi,
was widely respected for its religious heritage and community welfare work. With active involvement in the freedom movement of India, many of the family members were often jailed by the British. It was in this family Jayesh Joshi was born on 28th of May 1949. His father was a highly respected personality in his village, where he worked for the mass education of yoga vidya.
I request Kakodkar sir to felicitate Professor Joshi with shawl.
He strived to inculcate ethical and spiritual values in the minds of people.
And I request Vyas sir to felicitate him with a shrifal.
This was completely dedicated towards social welfare activities. With his passion for teaching and industrial design, Jayesh Raj Joshi chose reactor design as his research topic. With his extremely curious outlook, he would set up experimental equipment almost equivalent to commercial size. This balanced approach of theory and experiments were to be the hallmark of Dr. J B Joshi's next 35 years of research career. He became an associate lecturer at the age of 23, teaching his students a balanced approach of theory and experiments.
Professor Joshi always remains sources of inspiration to many of us. His students always consider him as father figure. Students of Professor Joshi also want to felicitate him. To felicitate on behalf of students of Professor Joshi, may I request Pandit sir to come on the dais and offer love and affection on behalf of all his students. I request Kakodkar ma'am to kindly come on the stage and felicitate Rujuta ma'am with shawl. National Center for Science Communicated, a dedicated body to disseminate science in society. A president of NCSC, Dr. Jayaraman, I request Dr. Jayaraman and his entire team to felicitate Joshi sir with a photo frame. Now I request I request Joshi sir to express his feelings on his occasion. Professor Jeshwaran sir. Yeah.
Masur is a village in the Satara district of Maharashtra. It was known by a family that resided here. This family, with its high moral values, was widely respected for its religious heritage and community welfare work. With active involvement in the freedom movement of India, many of the family members were often jailed by the British. It was in this family Jeshraj Joshi was born on 28th of May 1949. His father was a highly respected personality in his village, where he worked for the mass education of Yoga Vidya. With his teachings of Jnaneshwari and Dasabodh, he strived to inculcate ethical and spiritual values in the minds of people. Despite being in difficult economic condition, this family was completely dedicated towards social welfare activities. With his passion for teaching and industrial design, Jeshraj Joshi chose reactor design as his research topic. With his extremely curious outlook, he would set up experimental equipment almost equivalent to commercial size. This balanced approach of theory and experiments were to be the hallmark of Dr. J B Joshi's next 35 years of research career. He became an associate lecturer at the age of 23, teaching his students a balanced approach of theory and experiments. His students adored him as an affectionate, patient, and persuasive teacher. His visionary approach influenced many an industrialist. His large number of novel designs were implemented in various plants and industries. Among the fields where he did notable work was debottlenecking, now called as process intensification. In the year 1978, Dr. Jeshraj Joshi got married to Rujuta. After their marriage, his career consistently continued towards progress and success. He is a loving husband, an affectionate father, and a father-in-law. Dr. Joshi has guided 60 PhD students and an equal number of master's students. With his collaborators, he has published over 300 papers in international journals. Dr. Joshi has been conferred with more than 4,200 citations. He is an engineering teacher with largest number of citations in India. He is among the industry's most sought-after academic consultants in India and abroad. Dr. Joshi became head of Chemical Engineering Department in 1998. And director of UDCT in 1999 at the age of 50. UDCT was earlier a part of University of Mumbai. Through the efforts of Professor Sharma, it became the best postgraduate research institute in India. UDCT gained the status of an autonomous university in 2008. In this success, Dr. Joshi's contribution was phenomenal. During his tenure, UDCT registered tremendous development in all the quarters. Dr. Jeshraj Joshi is a visionary to the core, a hard-working intellectual, and a socially committed human being. The numerous national and international awards and accolades are just one side of the story. In a sense, when technology needed a humane catalyst, Dr. J B Joshi proved to be just that and much more.
Joshi sir, to express his feelings.
As per the timetable, 8:15 is over. I will be as brief as possible. My respected, highly revered guru, Professor Sharma, respected Dr. Kakodkar, Shri Vyas, Professor J.D. Yadav, Professor Gurubhar, Professor Vasudev Rao, Mrs. Kakodkar, distinguished invitees, my dear friends and dear students. First of all, let me express my gratitude to Atomic Energy Commission as well as Marathi Vidnyan Parishad for organizing this memorable event. So much has been said. I thank all the chairpersons as well as speakers. One point was brought out many times about my societal contributions. And I want to tell you some background. I was born in a small village called Masur in Satara district with a population of 3,000, where everybody used to know everybody. There was a school up to 7th standard of Jilla Parishad, and the education was free for everybody. After 7th standard, 8th to 11th, the fee was 5 rupees per month. But the families having annual income less than 1200 rupees, the education was free. And 95% of the families in the village, including our family, fell in that category, and the education was free. The teachers in the primary school as well as secondary school, they used to take extra lessons for those students who were remaining behind without any additional fee. There was one retired teacher in the village named Shri B.S. Budkar. He was teaching mathematics to all the students who approached him. And when I started taking lessons from him, he was 95. My father, every day, would take all the children in the age group of 8 to 16 to nearby river and for swimming and bath. Then he would teach yoga exercises, mainly Surya Namaskars, and also Gita. He taught Sanskrit to all those needy students in the village. Every village in Satara, Sangli, and Kolhapur district was having Professor Yadav will agree with me, akhadats. And wrestling was very popular, and wrestlers used to teach young ones, again, very free. What I'm trying to tell you from the beginning is why I started taking interest in societal work. In fact, and these even wrestlers were very, very highly respected in society. In fact, when I was given Padmabhusan, the villagers, after the elephant procession, they asked me in whose hands I should be felicitated. Immediately, I suggested the name of one wrestler, Hindkesari Ganpatrao Andadkar. Similarly, there were trainers for music, kirtan, sports, everything being free. Most probably because of this background, at the end of 11th standard, I developed liking for teaching. In fact, whatever education I would have taken, I would have ended up as a teacher. I also developed another interest. I was looking at the drudgery of farmers and the other craftsmen in the village. Household pollution was rampant. I was thinking of the possibility of reducing the drudgery by developing some software, some hardware. Of course, I was not having any clue for any of such development at that time. I also did not know the full meaning of the word design. My father, because of his standing in the village and social work and participation in the freedom movement, I got the right genes. And I take this opportunity to thank my parents, my village, and my villagers. Then I joined Science College at Karad. It was opened just a few years before I became eligible. Therefore, my seniors in the village could not take any science education. The fee was Rs. 250 per year and was again free for those whose family income was less than 1200 rupees per year. In addition, there was a facility of loan scholarship of Rs. 720 per year, and the loan had a provision of a waiver for payment for those who pick up a teaching profession. It was a big money, 720 rupees. In one of the hurricanes in those years, roof of my house had collapsed. It could be completely revamped in 720 rupees. I thank the government of Maharashtra for free education and the scheme of loan scholarship. I got admission in UDCT in 1967, and I used to wear then, I was a village boy, pajamas or half pant. But nobody teased me. My classmates then, who are and who were present, like Percy Kausmanek, Yogesh Kothari, Vijay Mahajani, and I was immediately assimilated among them. The fee was 400 rupees per year, and I got free ship. In addition, I got two scholarships worth 100 rupees per month, that is 1200 rupees. The mess bill was less than 50 rupees, and other expenses less than 10 rupees. So I could even send 40 rupees to my family. I received very high quality education and experience, and experienced very high quality ambience in UD City. I met my lifetime friends there who could attend today's function. Most important event was I met my lifetime teacher, Professor Sharma. I started research under his guidance. The funds for research were petty. However, Professor Sharma believed in high quality ideas. He offered me a problem in the area of design, and I jumped on it because the word design was deeply embedded in my heart. The first research problem was finding the characteristics of horizontal sparse contactors. I worked for 2 years and sent first publication. As usual, I received comments which demanded a mathematical model for pressure drop, gas fraction, and axial mixing. I took good 18 months for replying the comments, and Professor Sharma encouraged me all the time. Whenever gas is sparged in a pool of liquid, large size circulation cells are formed. Mathematically, these appeared typhoons for me, and I got trapped in these typhoons. During this period, I also received encouragement from Dr. Mashelkar. Eventually, I could quantitatively develop, which Professor Sharma mentioned a while ago, a relationship between flow pattern and axial mixing. In fact, it was the beginning of my 45 years of journey later. I was fascinated by deeper understandings of fluid mechanics and its relationship with reactor design. In the meantime, two more fortunate projects happened. Professor Sharma asked me to design an oxidizer for black liquor, which is an important unit process in paper and pulp industry. Again, I took good 18 months for the design. Most probably because I was trapped in circulation cells and I was not coming out of those typhoons. I was, after completing that first design, Professor Sharma thought, because he had another 40 design problems in his mind, looking at my priorities, the design problems were given to my friend Vinay Zuvekar, who is present here. He very efficiently completed them in less than 6 months. I remained closely associated and got immensely benefited. Later in my life, I designed hundreds and thousands of reactors. I think that such an opportunity, most probably very few people in the world might have received. Professor Sharma gave me yet another problem of understanding mass transfer and hydrodynamic characteristics of self-inducing impellers. I set up 1 meter diameter reactor and could produce a rate of induction which is more than the best known in the published literature, that is Denver flotation machines. And I became very, very proud. I was telling everybody that I'm getting induction rate more than 3 times the best known. And I told this to Sri K.V. Mariwala, whom you heard this morning, about this result. He immediately asked me to design a large-scale 5-ton reactor for hydrogenation. While I started the design, I quickly realized that the proposed reactor would need rates of induction 10 times higher than the best I had obtained in my research work. From that time onwards, I have become humble. By understanding the relationship between fluid mechanics in the vicinity of impeller and the rate of induction, I could achieve the objective of 10 times. And with the help of that understanding, even 50 times was possible. But this possibility became a reality only after understanding the science behind the fluid mechanics and its relationship with rate of induction. This incident was another lesson for my lifetime mission of understanding correlations between fluid mechanics and design objectives. I take this opportunity to express my gratitude to Professor Sharma. I have been privileged to be his student, and I'm also privileged that I became a part of UDCT ICT. As regards to gas-inducing reactor, the first one was implemented in Bombay Oil Industries. And then I must have implemented in more than 100 places, 100 reactors. Actually, I have lost the count now. And all of them are successfully running. That gave me a lot of confidence. The original idea was Professor Sharma. As a consultant, I was designing these reactors and earning fee. Professor Sharma never even hinted about he being the original idea generator. Not only that, he recommended my name to many more industries for such designs. Mr. Mariwala, he also gave me permission that after making one 5-ton reactor successful, I could implement it anywhere else. I sincerely thank Sri KVM and now Rajan Mariwala. I have then later on not only gas-inducing reactors, but many, many others. But because of strong support of Sri Yogesh Kothari, Sri Ravi Goenka, Madam Sandra Shroff, and Mr. Rao Saheb Patil, who is present here. Actually, wherever I started the relationship, it remained alive. With Mr. Mariwala, 45 years. With Yogesh Kothari, 40 years. With Ravi Goenka, 35 years. The newest one is 20 years old. At the same time, I started working with Hyco Industries and received plenty other opportunities for design. And these were implemented. This was the period of late 70s and early 80s. And I started working with small scale industries because they getting a technology support was difficult, is difficult. I'm happy that my dear friend Nandu Bhagwat, another friend Dilip Amdekar, Mr. Vilas Tamankar, are here today and they are continuing with successful plants which were developed in late 70s, early 80s. It was indeed a cheerful experience. Nandu Bhagwat, in addition to this professional relationship, inculcated a hobby of trekking, which I pursued till the age of 45. For getting deeper understanding in fluid mechanics and physics of turbulence, I started working in the area of computational fluid dynamics. It has been possible to make reliable predictions of design objectives. At that time, I took one more design problem from Chemopharma laboratories. That is, they were oxidizing picolines with nitric acid, and NOx gases were liberated. And the problem was to recover nitric acid from NOx gases. I designed the absorption system consisting of four columns with 98% recovery. The owner asked me, if I put two columns, then will I get 70%? And in the remaining two columns, 30%. I said yes. And he installed two columns. And we barely got 30% recovery. And if he would have put another two columns, it would have been 50%. This is yet another incident which made me humble. I took that problem to my heart and understood the basics of, this is the most complex problem in chemical engineering, having several reactions, several equilibria, several simultaneous mass transfers, desorptions, etc. And as Raviji mentioned in the morning, we established the first nitric acid recovery plant with 99% efficiency in his premises. We also developed technology for pollution abatement for NOx. And on the basis of these developments, we received a very coveted prize in chemical engineering, that is Kirkpatrick Award of the journal Chemical Engineering. With computational fluid dynamics and its experience, I started teaching fluid mechanics, multi-phase reactor design, started researching in the same areas, and did actual commercial implementations also in the same area. So whatever experience I was getting from the plants and from the research I was teaching, abundant problems for industry, those were taken for research, and all of them were interacting with each other. This is the gene of UDCT that Professor Sharma has been talking about. There is a statement of vision for every university that we shall generate new knowledge and disseminate it into society. The meaning is the same gene that you teach outstandingly in the classroom, do cutting edge research as compared to anywhere in the globe, and disseminate that knowledge in industry as well as society. With these understandings, I then must have designed hundreds of reactors, more than 2,000 reactors. And about 10 years ago, I got a confidence that I will design equipment and plant where the cost of production will be minimum as compared to anywhere in the world. And therefore, I started getting many offers. But my main interest was as a teacher and researcher. So I restricted myself, and even today, there are at least 10 industrialists from India as well as abroad, those who wish to take my help, but I'm seriously interested as a teacher. About 7 years ago, one USA-based company wanted to scale up a biotechnological reactor. The company people inquired with different universities in the USA. When Professor Mike Doherty listened to this request, he suggested my name, that you will get hardly anyone in USA. You better approach J B Joshi. First of all, I scaled up from 1 liter to 300 liters, then to 20,000 liters, and now to 300,000 liters, which is, as per the industry's requirement, is operating successfully. But I'm able to see the opportunity now for cutting the cost by 30 to 40%, or increase the capacity by 50 to 60%. During the age of 32 to 50 years, I received many awards and honors. And the first two together were INSA Young Scientist and IICH's Amar Daikem Award. Put together, the money was 10,000 rupees. I'm still proud about those 10,000 rupees. Our marriage cost was 7,000 rupees. And within 2 years, I received 10,000 rupees. I and my wife, then we had one agreement. The award money be used for making gold ornament, which will be for her, and the certificate will be mine. Both of us took a lot of interest in looking for new designs. We visited Jhaveri Bazaar and other shops several times, purchased books to make ornaments of our choice. I was amazed by the intricacies and the details which the artists are capable of. I'm also amazed by the different designs and color combinations of saris. And for enjoying the designs, I was accompanying my wife. We used to visit at least 4 to 5 shops before buying one sari. We spent one full day also in Kanchipuram and Paithani place. In fact, I have really deep respect for all kinds of artists, be them singers, music directors, script writers, painters, dedicated teachers. Actually, as a scientist and a practicing engineer, I would have liked to be called as artist, but that is not possible, because in an introduction of a learned journal, I write one sentence that the design of that equipment is still an art, and we need to develop science behind it. Because till it is an art, it is empirical, and the design will not be reliable. When I was 49, I got Goyal Foundation Award of rupees 1 lakh. My wife reminded me that I was becoming 50 the next year and remain ready for Vanaprasthashram. She said that she was no more interested in ornaments and sarees. My son also took similar stand. Perhaps all of you know a story in Ramayana. A robber, Valya, he was asked by Narad Muni to consult his wife and children that whether whatever I'm doing, is it okay with you? And the wife and the children, they replied saying that it is your business. We are not concerned about it. And then, of course, we know that the Walia robber, he became sage, a guest sage. Something like that happened to me. What I'm trying to tell you, why I took interest in societal research right from the beginning. I take this opportunity to thank my wife and my son. They have kept my feet always on the ground. Every month, I need to introspect and try to find the solution in possible behavior. I also thank my daughter-in-law, Meghana, who is added strength to our family. Because of my interest in society, so after 50 years, anyway, no saris were to be bought, no ornaments, so money was anyway excess. So I started giving back all the award money, many times even salary, to ICT then, and last 10 years to Marathi Vidyan Parishad, and very small amount to HBNI. One more major event happened at the age of 50. I became director of UDCT. I was indeed internally frightened. The administration of about 1,500 students, 100 teachers, and 300 non-teaching staff. I was reminded of the advice, and this has become very important in my life, advice of Swami Vivekananda. If you keep objective which is noble and approach it with unselfishness, you will get 100% success. I was also reminded of the teachings of Sant Ramdas. Those who make complaints in life never become successful. So always be smiling, positive, and with these qualities, you will get 100% success. So during this directorship of 10 years from 50 to 60, I took many projects, some simple, some difficult, some more difficult, some very difficult. But I had a very strong support of Dr. Meshelkar, who was the chairman of the governing board. I went back to the vision statement, which said that generate new knowledge and disseminate to the society. And as simply said by Professor Sharma, how to balance classroom teaching, research, and implementation in the society. So when we say that knowledge dissemination in the society, what is that society wants? And the principal problem of India is the country is poor. 140th from the top, 12th from the bottom. And mainly because it has similar ranking in innovations. So as a director, I thought to take up two projects that whether the research could have a component of innovation and increase the number from whatever it was to 100. We worked as a team for getting autonomy to begin with. And I was helped by my colleagues Professor Samant, Professor Kanetkar, Professor Shennai, Professor Akkamanji, Professor Teli, Professor Shukla, Professor Pai, Professor Yadav, Professor Pandit, and many, many others. First of all, to get 100 such PhD fellowships. In the morning you heard about DAE ICT Center for Atomic Energy, and there was a provision of 100 PhD fellowships. Then there was a possibility to set up DBT ICT Center for Bioprocess Technology, Biosciences, and it had additional provision of 30 PhDs. Then the subject of process intensification, that generated another 50 fellowships. And faculty earned different government and industry projects. Thus, the institution had a compounded growth of 25% every year in terms of external revenue generation. At the end of my tenure, the external revenue generation through projects and consultancy was more than 8 times the government funding put together. Ours is a state university. I checked up at that time such earnings of state universities throughout the world, and I felt very happy at that time that 8 times was not attained by any university. The publications and the citations doubled, and as per Summerfield report, chemical engineering marked 6th position in the world. The institution received full autonomy in 2004 and deemed university status in 2008. And at this point, UDCT became ICT in 2008. Money was collected for 400 room, 7-story hostel, 22-floor faculty house, and 35 crores for DAE ICT Center, thanks to Dr. Kakodkar and Dr. Banerjee. Two more events happened at the age of 50. When I became director, I realized that about 25 lakh rupees were needed for expenditure on some part of library, electricity, water, gardening, and many other expenses like this. Exactly at the same time, ICMA had organized a workshop on process intensification, for which Mrs. Sandra Shroff was present. After my lecture, Sandra Madam suggested me to visit their Ankleshwar factory. After the plant visit, I indicated the possibility of saving 50 crores per year. She asked me about my fee, and I quickly replied, 25 lakhs. The amount that ICT needed. She agreed and started supporting all the bills will go to her, and she would pay. Once I requested her to assign such 25 lakh rupees for renovation of toilets, she independently took the estimate, which was 50 lakh rupees for 18 toilets. So she not only gave this 50 lakh rupees additional money, but not only money, she personally supervised all the renovations. The ICT is fortunate to have very long-term relationships which have been inculcated by my predecessors, in particular Professor Sharma, like Mr. K.V. Mariwala, Dr. Gharda, the Parekh Group, the Arati Group, the Reliance Group, and many others. We have their purses available for the cause of ICT. Professor Yadav has taken this to yet higher level. The second event at 50 was the formation of Energy Group, consisting of Mr. Mariwala, Mr. Shirish Patel, whom you heard in the morning, Dr. G.K. Bhide, former scientist in BRC and who was the director of MEDA, Maharashtra Energy Authority, Mr. Bhagwat Devidayal, who is there in the audience, myself, and Professor Anirudha Pandit. Company Sanjay Technoplast was also a member. I'm sure Mr. Prasad Kokir and Sunil Pathak are there in the audience. The object was to develop technology for a non-formal sector of the society, developments of cook stoves. We started from 12% and with computational fluid dynamics. I had heard a success story of internal combustion engines and the collaboration of Chrysler and Ford with the universities, Princeton, and how with the help of computational fluid dynamics, the efficiency of internal combustion engines was improved from 25% to 40%. And when I visited Princeton, and there was a fluid mechanics group, on the doorsteps itself, there was a big banner, in next 5 years, we shall improve the efficiency of internal combustion engines from 40% to 60%. By CFD simulating cook stoves, slowly we attained 40%. And right now I'm telling you that number to be conservative, but take it for 40%. And I feel like putting a banner now in ICT that in next 5 years, we shall take the efficiency of cook stoves from 40% to 60%. There was yet another energy group focusing on solar energy. US National Academy of Engineering has declared a grand challenge for the development of solar thermal technology with per meter square cost less than $75. The group consisting of Professor Panse, Dr. Vishwanath, myself, and students have been able to achieve this. It is less than 4,000 rupees now, which is much less than $75. A paper based on this development was published in Nature, Climate Change. One point I must emphasize at this stage that whatever successes I have been telling you, these belong to the students in ICT. I like their dedication, their analytical mind, and hard work. I was personally fortunate to work with 115 PhD students and 60 master students. At the age of 60, Dr. Kakodkar invited me for the DAE Home Baba chair professorship. When I met him after I got the appointment letter, he said that we have an hidden agenda for you. I listened to that. I, of course, did not understand what is the hidden agenda. But now, after 10 years, I'm very clear about that entire agenda. Quickly, I realized that Atomic Energy Commission, but I was connected to BRC at that time, is a heaven for researchers. Firstly, all the problems being solved were real. Secondly, all the facilities, name anything, and any expertise, name anything, were available in BRC. Then I started close association with BRC, IGCAR, Heavy Water Board, Rare Earth, and many others. All the scientists have accommodated my involvement. I would like to give all the successes to these scientists in these projects. But wherever I participated, like synthesis and scale-up of carbon nanotubes, recently there is a news that PMO office has given an order of 200,000 jackets. I need to confirm this is the news. This is a news item. Bulletproof jackets, passive systems for atomic reactors, collection of basic data for designing and scale-up of dissolvers, liquid-liquid extraction, crystallization, ion exchange, chromatographic separation, etc. While collaborating with reactor engineering group, extensive application of computational fluid dynamics, as explained by Dr. Nayak, was needed. I started teaching a class of 40 every year. And the result is, you saw a book which is just released. About 25 PhDs have been trained for the use of the technique of computational fluid dynamics and the design of the components of HWR. At the age of 65, I started feeling that I have made substantial contributions to the society, and I should feel comfortable that what society has given, I have paid back. And then I received Padmabhusan. That point onwards, I never utter a word that I'm going to pay back to the society. Today's felicitation function is yet another contribution from the society for me. So I'm going to remember it as a treasure, and I take this as a responsibility to serve the society with much more vigor than it has been happening till today. At the same time, I became president of Marathi Vidyan Parishad. Earlier, I said that India is poor mainly because of lack of innovations. If innovations are to grow, then soil has to be fertile, which means the development of scientific temper in the society. For this purpose, Marathi Vidyan Parishad has 20 different programs. I quickly became part of it. Most of the MVP staff is here. I thank them all for their contributions. You learned the story of the science on Saturday. This year, the students from 500 schools are going to do experiments themselves. Next year, we are planning to have more than 1,000 schools. We have taken a project of increasing productivity of soil for oil seeds. All of you know, perhaps, that in terms of every other agricultural produce, we are self-sufficient, but we are importing oil seeds worth 72,000 crores. The presentation you saw this morning, he has been able to achieve the growth in the range of 30% to 60%. But if it is only 50% and whatever land is assigned for oil seeds, with 50% growth rate, we don't need to import. That solves the problem. So we have to take it further to the farmers. I'm now in touch with a very good organization, Bharat Vikas Group, and they have a network of 10 lakh farmers. I met them last week, and they have they're terribly interested in taking this project further. Then looking at this success, the MIT professors, they invited me for collaboration. collaboration in two areas. One, of course, increasing the productivity of land. And they are terribly interested in converting the biomass into biochar, and biochar to be used as a fertilizer or soil conditioner. Recently, I visited MIT and developed an agreement. They have a 50 kg per hour pilot plant, which is to be scaled up to begin with to 5 tons per hour, then maybe even 100 tons per hour. But the pilot plant, since at least in that group in MIT, the simulation expertise of computational fluid dynamics together with the particle dynamics, I quickly realized that the design is really suboptimal. They are not getting constant quality, and productivity is very poor for the money we spend for the. I expressed my ideas, and they have accepted my ideas. And the next 50 kg per hour pilot plant is to be installed in India. I frankly discussed with them that the technology is so generated, if you wish, we can take intellectual property, but it should not come in any case in the way of using it by Indian farmers. MIT shall not charge anything for the Indian farmers. Then I'm interested. And that professor has already agreed. The second problem in which MIT is interested is to reduce household pollution by cook stoves using biomass. They have developed a very economical gadget for measuring particulate matter, NOx, SOx, carbon monoxide, less than 10,000 rupees. But they want CFD simulations of different kitchens. So they want to undertake such a survey of two villages and simulate all the kitchens and eventually the entire village and try to find the solution. One is, of course, use improved cook stoves and whether there can be change in the design. Similarly, biomass is used in Uttarakhand for keeping house warm, and there is also heavy pollution. The data says that 16 lakh women and children, they die because of household pollution. I have also become a soldier in a project of Dr. Kakodkar called Silage. The meaning is simple. The city scientist should either locate themselves in village and take up their real problems, or while they are in their institutions, take up the problems. Or there are many engineering colleges in villages. The faculty from there should take up the. So this is a simple meaning. Identify the problem to be solved and then make development. Personally, I'm very confident about the capability of young students. In Marathi Vidyan Parishad, we have titled this project as Prosperity Through Science and Technology. We have held extensive workshops for undertaking societal problems. We have prioritized them, and to begin with, we have taken only two. One is the fruits, the valorization of fruits. I extensively traveled in Konkan area, and 2.1 million tons of cashew apples are thrown. 1.6 million tons of jackfruits are thrown. So if all these fruits are put together, you will be happy to know that the per capita income of India is 1 lakh rupees, that of Konkan is about 60,000 rupees, and here is opportunity to increase the income by 80,000 rupees by solving these two problems. We will also continue to undertake the problem of improving the soil fertility. You just now saw the release of a book on CFD. Most of it is in multi-phase phenomena. Now, I have been invited by Springer to edit yet another big handbook of Perry's handbook size for computational fluid dynamics for multi-phase systems. 6 years ago, a garden type of conference was organized in Canada, mainly for understanding multiphase flows and associated direct numerical simulations and other techniques of computational fluid dynamics and DPM, DEM. And I was requested to inaugurate that conference. And at the end of the conference, I was also requested to write a report, the status report, and Journal of Fluid Mechanics has agreed to publish that status report. I wish to continue this activity of garden conference, but now my mind says that I'm going to weigh the time required by our society versus the time for these conferences. And most probably my today's conclusion is I will try to take up problems of our own society. I again thank the organizers, the Atomic Energy Commission, the BRC, Marathi Vidyan Parishad, Shri A.P. Deshpande, Dr. Nayak, Dr. Mukesh. I thank all the chairpersons, speakers, volunteers, and sponsors. I accept this felicitation with utmost humility. I will keep today's event as a treasure in my memory, and I will now onwards work with more vigor. Thank you, one and all. It seems I have taken longer time. I apologize for that.
Thanks a lot, sir. May I request Nilesh Kulkarni, sir, to offer a vote of thanks. Okay, on behalf of organizers, I request all of you to have a standing ovation to Professor J. B. Joshi. Thanks a lot. Please be seated for just few seconds now. I request Kulkarni sir, he would like to say a few words.
Good evening, all of us. First of all, thanks for J.B. Joshi sir and all respective members. And special thanks to DE person Dr. Nayak and Mukesh ji for giving us a chance to sponsor this event. Once again, thanks to all.
I thank all the dignitaries in the audience. I thank one and all for gracing today's occasion and making it a memorable day. On behalf of organizers, I extend my sincere thanks to sponsors 3D Engineering and Lakshmi Organics Limited. Any representatives of them, if they are there, please come on the stage. Sir. Yes, please. With heart filled with gratitude on behalf of management committee, I announce hereby that we are closing the day.
Mementos.
To whom?
Memento list.
Okay, some moment. Okay, Deshpande sir is taking charge of the further part of the function.
Memento list. Dr. Parul Sheth, Dr. Smita Lele, and Dr. Manse Rajadaksha. They did the excellent job of Master of Ceremony. So I invite Dr. Parul Sheth to accept the fruit basket. Some mementos over here to remember the function, today's function. First, Dr. Kakodkar. Gautam Vishwas. Dr. Singhrai from NPCIL. No. Mukesh Kumar. Dr. Mohanty. Dr. Vyas. Vyas, you will help in Marathi Vignan Parishad, maybe through Gujarati. You have a desire to spread the knowledge. Thank you. Thanks a lot to the entire audience who is sitting here right from the... Oh, sorry. Dr. Vasudev Rao. Dr. Grover. Dr. Manasi Rajadeksha. She is about to escape. Some memento to you. Dr. Parul Sheth. Dr. Smita Lele.
And one more person who is quite instrumental in this program, Shri Anand Deshpande. I'll present him.
Thank you to all of you. Now we are breaking for cocktails and dinner.